Hi, I'm Jim Sanderson. It's great to be here at Wildlife Conservation Expo, and it's great to see all of you again. And I see many new faces out there too. It's great to be among the faithful. Well, I work for Global Wildlife Conservation, where I'm the program manager for wildcat conservation. I've been a partner with Wildlife Conservation Network for nearly 20 years. And I founded and I'm director of the Small Wildcat Conservation Foundation. What is it we do? Well, our mission is to conserve all 33 species of small wild cats and their habitats worldwide. You can see three small cats here you probably have never seen before. To do that, I work with colleagues and friends all around the world to reduce threats to small cats and their habitats. So here are three of my colleagues, Ashanthu Gugula in Sri Lanka, Oaken Byron and Buyan Delger in Mongolia, and Constanza Napolitano in Chile. Last December, we had our second small cat summit in Sri Lanka, and you can see here about 3/4 of the people in the world that work on small cat conservation. There are not a lot of us, and there needs to be a lot more. What do we mean by threats? So I want to give you an example of what we do. Free-ranging chickens all around the world are a threat to small cats. People allow their chickens to free range, and this is like free food for weenias. So the weenia sees free food, what do? We go get the free food. And when we do, there's retaliatory killing for all the dead chickens, and we usually end up with a dead small cat. So that's the threat, free-ranging chickens. What do about that threat? Well, we work with people to mitigate the threat. In this case, I built this woman a new hen house. Now she doesn't have any retaliatory killing for weenias. Here's a landowner in Chile who said, I could study weenias on her property if I removed all of them when I was done. And you can see the difference here when they actually get to see the cat up close and personal. Now, this little cat killed all of her chickens in one night. Well, she wasn't very happy, but you can see the smile on her and her daughter's face now when they actually get to see the cat up close and personal. Conservation is really a social science. We work with people to reduce threats. At the first small cat summit in the UK in 2017, I got to meet my colleague Badru Mugerwa from Uganda. He kept sending me these pictures of African golden cat that he was getting on his camera traps. African golden cat is the least known cat in all of Africa. And let's face it, none of you go to Africa to see an African golden cat. It's just impossible. But Badru was getting them on his cameras and kept sending them to me. And here he is, my good colleague, Badru Mugerwa. I've invited him to be my guest and share the podium to talk to you about his project on African golden cat. Please welcome my dear colleague, Badru Mugerwa.
Hello, greetings from Uganda. My name is Badru Mugerwa. As I said, I come from Uganda, where I work to conserve the African golden cat, or the Embaka, as we call it, or the goldies, as I prefer calling it. Much of my work involves directly engaging local communities in implementing conservation, community-based conservation initiatives to stop poaching. And we do this through pigs and smiles, as you hear more about this in the coming slides. So just a brief history between me and the African golden cat. This history goes back 2010, when I recorded my first ever camera trap image of the African golden cat in what was by then my first ever camera trap survey, which was a survey designed by the Tropical Ecology and Assessment Monitoring Network. So because these guys are super elusive and they also often occur in small numbers, it took me 5 years to finally have a physical encounter with the African golden cat. And even then, it's not the kind of the first encounter I had dreamt of. It was short-lived, maybe a minute at most. But again, if you're working with this kind of cool, you know, cool unique species, this is all you can get, you know, a minute of a direct physical sighting. And I'm glad to say that I'm not the only one, you know, that has had that these cats have been elusive to. Scientists over years, they have had a hard time understanding the African golden cat. Going way back in the 1800s when it was first, you know, discovered, it took scientists a hundred years to finally find a name for these guys, which is not surprising because, you know, it's one species, you know, with three different color appearances. That must have been confusing in 1826. Still, even now, we don't really know much about the cats. All we know is that it's vulnerable as classified by the International Union of Conservation of Nature. And we know that they are restricted or they are endemic in the dense forests of equatorial Africa, stretching from West Africa to Central Africa to Western Uganda. That's basically all we know. You know, we don't know much about these species. And even then, this distribution map, we actually think that it's outdated in a sense that it was built or developed based on records that are very, very old. I'll give you an example. This map shows that the species occurs in Angola, but the record in Angola is from the 1800s, based on a trader who was selling skin. The same story applies in West Africa, for instance, like in Sierra Leone. The record we have from Sierra Leone goes back 2 decades, you know. So we are concerned and indeed worried that the species may not still be present as this, you know, map shows here. So for 2 years now, we started this online initiative whereby we contact people doing research or working in the tropical rainforests of Africa, asking them for records of the African golden cat. And these records are, you know, should be accompanied or verifiable with a picture, a camera trap picture or the equivalent. And the idea here is that we need to ascertain the areas in Africa or across the species range while the species is still present. That will help us to identify the threats the species may be facing, and in return, it will help us design direct threat reduction or conservation initiatives in these areas. For instance, we know that across Africa or across the tropical rainforest of Africa, poaching or illegal hunting for wildlife is widespread. You know, people hunt all sorts of things in these forests for food and for other reasons. And this has a huge, serious threat on the long-term survival of the African golden cat and other species which are, you know, endemic in African forests. For instance, in our own work in Uganda, we have learned that where poachers, the guys I'm showing in the picture here, where poachers are present, the African golden cat is perishing. And in areas where there are no poachers, the African golden cat is thriving. So this is a huge difference. This is a huge difference and a huge threat that poaching may pose on these species. So in Uganda, where we work, it's very surprising and also very interesting because in these three areas shown on the map of Uganda in the southwestern part of the country where I work, people don't eat carnivores, people don't eat primates, don't eat monkeys, and they associate them to be a taboo. So anyone who eats a monkey or a carnivore, the community looks at you in some way, you know, like, oh my God, that's so gross, you know, like that kind of look. But from the slide I've just shown you, there is a clear signal that where poaching is happening, poaching for, you know, bush pigs and forest antelopes, which people often go for, the African green cats are not, you know, performing well in these areas. And the reason is, where poaching is happening, people use really crude tools and techniques in form of snares and traps. And what these do, they catch anything that passes by or that puts a foot in them. They are super unselective, that they catch even things poachers are not interested in this case, the African golden cats, in something I prefer to call collateral damage. You know, like people are targeting other wildlife, but at the end, the golden cats tend to be victims to these traps. And that's really sad, because only in the last year, you know, when we did our survey, we asked the poachers and the Uganda Wildlife Authority rangers who work in the forests on a daily basis, how many cats they found in snares in that 1 year, between February 2018 to February 2019, and we recorded 81 African game cats that were caught in snares. People set snares there, they catch these animals, and the animals are left there to rot or to, you know, go through a very slow, painful death. So what we are doing to stop these cats from being killed is that we work with communities. We actually talk to the local people. We approach them to learn more about poaching, to learn more about the reasons why they do poaching, and to learn more about what are the possible interventions or ways that the stakeholders, you know, the conservationists, the Uganda Wildlife Authority, you know, the government, how can these stakeholders help and all work with the communities to find solutions to stop poaching? So from talking to these communities, we have learned that the key drivers, the key reasons as to why people participate in poaching, despite the knowledge that poaching is illegal and fully punishable by the law, is that because people are desperate for food and that they're desperate for income. So they suggested an intervention that can meet both of these two, you know, life demands, food and money. And they suggested pigs. So what we did, we introduced pig farming to the communities, because people can sell the piglets when the female pig gives birth, like after 5-6 months. You know, they sell the piglets, they get money to pay school fees, to pay their bills. And they keep some, you know, around the household for food. So this is, we feel and we're observing that actually this is something that, you know, is solving two problems at the same time: need for money, need for food. And even more interesting, or even more important for us and the communities, is that this pig farming, it's not an initiative to only benefit the poachers. It's an initiative that is there to benefit the whole community. And the way we have designed it as a pig seed bank. And the way it works, we give a female pig to a poacher. 5 months later, when this pig gives birth to piglets, the poacher is obliged to give one female piglet to his nearest neighbor. And the idea here is that the benefits, you know, trickle from the poachers to their neighbors around. And in return, we get some sort of community policing against poaching and other illegal activities around the national parks where we work. So the communities actually report other individuals from the communities who are participating in poaching. So this is very important for us. And this picture I'm showing you, a gentleman, our dear friend, Mr. Kakuru, who was a very notorious poacher in the past. And I want to tell you that today, because of the initiatives I've put in place, he has become one of our most important ambassadors in the fight against poaching in the national parks where we work. So these initiatives are directly inspiring a behavioral change within the communities, which is very, very important for the long-term survival of the species we are working to conserve. And the second initiative we have, which loops back to what I mentioned at the beginning, the smiles, is our mobile dental clinics, in which we hop from village to village, providing free mobile dental treatment and oral health care to local communities, who in return, they provide us with the much needed community policing against poaching. And also, you know, it adds value to conservation. You know, like, these are services people find inaccessible most of the times. And when we provide these kind of services for free, by the way, it kind of adds value to conservation. People tend to appreciate having these cats in their background, or having their wildlife in their background. So this work, you know, wouldn't be possible without the generous support of our dentists on the wheels, as we call them, led by Dr. Hazel Simila and also Dr. Bob Masiko, who basically take on all the dentistry work with the local communities. And if you want to know more about our work and what we do, please check us out on savingafricangoldencat.com. And we also have a podcast, and this is a website where you can listen to our podcast about the kind of work we do. Our work would be impossible without our esteemed supporters and partners, the Uganda Wildlife Authority, which is the government office in charge of wildlife and national park, the Muhammad Bin Zayed Species Conservation Fund, the Small Wild Cat Conservation Foundation, the Institute for Tropical Forest Conservation, and the National Foundation of Science. And I wish to thank you for listening about our work and what we do. And I look forward to hearing, you know what you think about what we do, how we can improve. If you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer them as well. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Badru, for your presentation. I'd like to tell you more about our small cat projects around the world. In South Asia, we've created the Fishing Cat Conservation Alliance. This is a new NGO as an umbrella organization for all the people working on fishing cat conservation throughout the range of the fishing cat. So we have a new project now in Pakistan that completes range coverage for fishing cats. In Nepal, Sagar Dahal found that fishing cats were being killed because they were killing people's chickens. So Sagar helped people create new hen houses, build new hen houses, repair old hen houses to prevent the killing of fishing cats. Sagar has also created awareness programs and built a conservation network across Nepal. So these young people are his eyes and ears throughout Nepal. In Sri Lanka, Anya and Ashan are trying to save fishing cats throughout Sri Lanka, not just in one place, but throughout the whole country. And to do this, you need a network of people. We created a rescue center for fishing cats, sort of an end-to-end solution, conservation solution. We need rescue centers for kittens, and then we rehab and release them. Here's two fishing cats sitting on top of a waterfall. And Ashan has created youth camps to build his conservation network throughout Sri Lanka. So these are his eyes and ears. When anything goes wrong, Ashan gets a phone call. In India, Tyas is working with young people to save fishing cats. Murthy is working in Eastern India. Here he's giving a lecture to young people. And Girihard Mala working with fishermen and young people to save fishing cats. In Cambodia, Vanessa Munoz is working with rangers on her camera trap program to document fishing cats. And she's also working with the community. So this is, again, an end-to-end conservation solution. We work with young people to change the future, and we work with communities to change the present. In Chile, we've been working since 1997 to conserve huinas. Our program is now active throughout the range of the huina in Chile. And here's a picture of young people learning about huinas. In Mongolia, I'm working with Buyan Delger and Okan Bayer on Manul, palace cats. Here's a young man being interviewed and naming his marmot. Buyan Delger did her PhD on marmot reintroduction. Marmots are important because the palace cats den and have their kittens in burrows dug by marmots. As you can see, conservation is really a social science. We work with people to better their lives, and in doing so, they help us save our small cats around the world. Thank you. Thank you for joining Wildlife Conservation Network's Expo. Badru and I would be happy to answer any questions that you have. Thank you.